Now we can go back to our problem. We're going to solve this problem now. Okay, any questions on how we came to this structure, to the previous structure? Any questions on this? Any questions on this? Okay. Okay, now we can then continue if you have no questions. Now, what is linear programming? Linear programming is actually the structure that we have seen in the previous slide. It's either you maximize or you minimize a linear objective function subject to linear constraints. So if you go to the previous page, all the constraints and the objective function is linear. How do we understand that it's linear? Okay, how do we understand that they are linear? You can see that this is a linear functional form. In other words, here we have 10a plus 8.5g, which is actually a line that has two variables, a and g. So it's a linear line. Similarly, 3a plus 2g is also a line. If we had more variables, the linearity structure is not going to change as long as this holds. Now, what do we mean by something which is not linear? It can be a nonlinear function, like we could have a square or square root of a or square root of g in this whole structure, and then it will be nonlinear. Okay? So this is linear because all the constraints and everything are linear. So these type of structures where we maximize or minimize a linear objective function with linear constraints, okay, then we call it linear programming. Now, you can immediately say the following, which was said in 1940 in a academic meeting when somebody was introducing, George Danzig was introducing linear programming, and a very old and well-known mathematician raised his hand and said that real life is not linear. So what is the use of this technique? And it turns out that the answer is very simple. Of course it is not linear, but it can be linearized, which means that if you remember the approximations that you learned in calculus, you can linearize functions within some ranges. So life, real life is not as simple, but on the other hand, real life complexities can be approximated by these structures. So this is actually the importance of linear programming in the sense that a lot of functional forms can be simplified and put in the linear structure. Of course, in general, we call these type of problems as mathematical programming problems. This is the jargon that we have. So the objective function can be nonlinear or linear. The constraints can be linear or nonlinear. But the structure is always the same. You minimize or maximize something, and you have a number of constraints that limits your optimization of the functional form. In calculus, the optimization problems that you see, maximization or minimization problems that you see, are usually without constraints. Whereas here, we have a large number of constraints that makes the problem a little bit more difficult because you don't allow the decision variables to take arbitrary values. Okay? This is actually something which is very important. Now, in this department, you're going to learn linear programming. You're going to learn, in some courses, elective courses, some nonlinear programming problems as well. But the interesting part is that if we again go to the previous page, okay, this structure, if you forget about the numbers, can be represented in a very simple form. The objective function is a function, a vector, of you know the vector multiplication, am I right? Okay, so you have a vector A multiplied with a vector x, and you want to maximize or minimize that, where A is your parameters, 10, 8.5, and x is your decision variables, and they are all vectors. One of them is a row vector, the other one is a column vector. You multiply them, subject to a number of constraints which involve the decision variables, and then you have the right-hand sides. This is, if we had equalities, life could have been much simpler, because we know how to deal with equalities. But when we have inequalities, it is not as simple. But you can see that you can define more variables and make these equalities. But the number of variables then would be more than the number of the number of rows, which means that if we had inequalities, we have infinite number of solutions. Okay, you cannot follow me, because this is what you're going to learn in linear algebra. This is actually a linear structure which can be handled mathematically in a very certain, very structured way. You will learn how to deal with these type of structures in that course first. Basic definitions will be made in that course. And then in another course, you're going to learn how to apply those basic properties to solve this problem in general. Okay, any questions on this? Okay, let's go to the next slide. Now, what we can do is, this is a simple problem. We can geometrically represent this problem. Okay, now if we had three decision variables, it would have been a little bit difficult for me to do that. But I would use the 3D printer that I have at home. Okay, always remember that. If you have anything to do, I will be able to supply that machine to you. But if we had four variables, then we cannot do anything, unfortunately. Okay, but for two variables, we have this geometrical form, which is going to be very useful to describe the problem structure. Now, let's describe this problem using this figure. In the vertical axis, we have g, which is the number of grounded shoes, named grounded, that we are going to manufacture. It will describe that. This axis will describe the number of A's. I don't remember the name. Okay, that to produce. Now, what we're going to do is, we're going to draw the inequalities that we have in the previous formulation, and we will represent the problem geometrically. So let's start doing that. Now, what was the first constraint? Tell me what the first constraint was. Machine constraint. Tell me the numbers. 3a plus 2b, 2g is less than or equal to what? 12,000. Okay. Now, if I devote all the machine capacity to manufacture A's, what would be the number of A's that I would be able to produce? Okay. So the number of A's that I can produce is 4,000. This is the point. Now you can sign this point on your notes as well. Now, if I use the machine capacity all for G's, how many G's can I produce? 6,000. So you can see that this is the other part. Now, what is the meaning of the line that connects these two points? I am assuming that I will be using all my capacity. If I use all my capacity for G, 6,000 is the total number of G's that I can produce with zero A's. If I devote all my capacity to A, I will be able to produce 4,000 A's and zero G. Now, what is the let's use this number. What is this number? This number gives me the combination of G and A that I can produce using that capacity. So this is the ultimate, if I use all the capacity, this line simply is showing me the total amount of A and G that I can produce. Now, can I, for example, be on this part of this line? No, because capacity is not going to be enough. Let's make a simple check. Can I manufacture 5,000 A's? No. Okay, so this part that you see of this line is not feasible. In other words, given the problem description, I cannot have any production quantities which is on this side of this line. Everything that I can do is actually below, if I define below in this direction, okay, so this is the direction of below, okay, then everything that I have here can be manufactured. Okay, any questions on this? Let's do the same thing for the second constraint. What is the second constraint? Okay, second constraint is 7A plus 8G is less than or equal to 34,000. Now let's draw that constraint again. Now if I have everything devoted to A, what will be the total amount of A that I can produce? 34,000 divided by 7, which is a number right over here. Okay, it is somewhere, it's a little bit larger than, less than 5,000, I suppose. No, it's a little bit less than 6,000. Okay, so it is that point. Similarly, if I devote everything to G, okay, if I devote everything to G, it will be 34,000 divided by 8 Gs, which will be actually this number over here, 4,000 something. Now, if I connect these two lines, these two points with a straight line, I will be actually representing the second constraint on this graph. Similar logic. The upper part of this constraint, okay, the upper part of this constraint is not feasible. The only part which is feasible is the part that looks to the origin. Okay? So this is actually, this is the region where the second constraint tells me that you can have your production figures. So this is the line that I have. Now, if I combine those two with the non-negativity constraints. Remember, we also have non-negativity constraints. Non-negativity means that G cannot be negative. So this is the line where beyond this, G is going to take negative values. So I'm not going to allow that. I am only going to allow values of G that are above this zero line. Similarly, values of A below on this side of the zero line is not acceptable. Only the values of A on this side are acceptable. So now what I have is, I have the so-called, my feasible region. What is that feasible region? This actually determines this part. This determines this part, and this is my feasible region. So this straight line, and then I go to another line, and then I have these two non-negativity constraints determining my feasible region. This is called the feasible region. What is the meaning of feasible region? Any questions before I explain the meaning of feasible region again? Any questions on this? I am simply representing the inequalities on this graph. Luckily, it is only a two-dimensional problem. If it was three dimensions, I would have another facility to, I will need another facility to show it to you. But four dimensions, we cannot do anything. And how do I am setting the dimensions? The number of decision variables actually determines the dimension of the problem. Okay. Any questions on this? So what is feasible region then? Feasible region is this blackened region for this problem, it simply tells you the possible A and G values that you can pick up. Now, what is the problem if I restate the problem? The problem is I am going to select A and G values from this blackened region, and I will try to maximize my profit given this blackened region. Okay, so that's the problem that I have. Any questions on this? Now, how many possible solutions do I have in this problem? How many possible solutions do I have in this problem? 16. Somebody said 16. Any other guesses? Infinity is the correct answer. Because each point here is actually a solution to your problem. And this is an area. Okay, the less you understand, the more you talk. Okay. So again, listen to me. We have infinite number of possible solutions here. Because any point that you see on this area, which is blackened, is a solution actually. It's a solution to your production planning problem. In other words, let's take this 2000 and 2000 point. It is a solution to your problem. You can check it actually with the constraints, whether it is a solution or not. It's written right over here. This is another solution. You have infinite number of solutions. Yes? Yes? A and, okay, that's another thing. A and G might need to be an integer. You're right, actually. You can say that it's an integer. But of course, I didn't tell you about the scaling. Maybe each unit here is 100,000 shoes. So you are right, it is going to be an integer. But in this scale, the solution to manufacture 389.5 shoes is not going to be that important because it's either 390 or 389. It's not that important, but if we ignore the fact that it should be an integer, there are infinite number of solutions. Even if it is integer, we have a very large number of solutions. Anyhow, okay. Questions? Yes? Okay, we're going to come to that. This is the next thing that we're going to do. Okay. Now, of course, in these type of problems, when you have infinite number of possibilities, you need to have a very nice structure in order to make sure that you can obtain the optimal solution. So remember, in one lecture, I was talking about structural properties. This problem has a very interesting structural property that makes our life easy when we are solving this problem. Now, you're going to see that in 202, actually. I will explain what it is, but you're going to see how one can show that it's actually a very nice property. We're going to do it. You're going to see the details in the other course. Okay. Any questions from this page? Yes? Again, can you repeat? I couldn't hear you, so. Yes. Okay, you're right, actually. In a given week, you can produce 8.5 shoes, because basically a worker can start assembling a shoe and leave half of it to the next week. So your friend is saying that it can be a non-integer value as well, which is a very correct observation. You're right. Thank you. So it is a rate, actually. This is the approximate number. So you're going to, of course, complete that shoe. It's not going to be half. Okay. Questions? Another question or comment? Very, very good comment. Thank you. Okay. Let's go to the next page. Okay. So this is what we have here. So for those of you who read the notes, maybe at most one person, okay, the answer was here. Any point in the feasible region is a solution. So it means that we have an area, so we have infinite number of solutions. Okay, one can compute the profit of each solution. This is the technique that we used to do, remember? We would, but here we cannot do that. We're finished, actually. Okay? We can only have ourselves doing that computation for a limited amount of time. Now, of course, we want the solution that will yield us the maximum profit. Now, meaning of the decimal point, we already discussed that. Okay. So, next one. Okay. Now, how are we going to solve this problem? One way of looking at this problem is as follows. Now, can I show the objective function on this graph? So, question is again, can I show the objective function on this graph? Now, of course, you can see that in order to be able to show the objective function on this graph, what I need to do is I need to find out certain solutions that will yield exactly the same objective function value. Now, what was the objective function? By the way, I checked it's 8.5 is correct. So let's write it here. The objective function is 10a plus 8.5g. Okay. Any questions that you want to ask me? Okay. I have this. There is a continuous murmuring coming from this side or from this side. I cannot differentiate. It's not coming from the middle. Okay, yes. Okay, we already passed that. Good morning, yes? Okay, your friend answered that question actually in a beautiful way. This is the rate of producing shoes every week. So the rate can be 8.5. You can start producing part of the shoe in a given week, continue next week. Okay. You can see her later on. Okay. Okay, any other question? No questions, of course. I already intimidated you. Okay. Any questions, frankly? Instead of asking to your friend, you can ask me. Okay. You finished your job. You can do anything you want. Okay. Okay. Now, this is the objective function value. Now, what I want to do is I want to show the objective function on this graph as well. So how am I going to do that? Let's think different ways of doing it. Now, my proposal is as follows. Find me two a and g value, which is going to give exactly the same objective function value. So tell me an a and g, and another a and g, so that 10a plus 8.5g is exactly the same. Is it? Okay, let's think for a while. Okay. Very simple. Yes. Okay. If you cannot answer the question, listen to your friend. Yes.
For example, 0g 4000a.
Okay. 0g 4000a. Yes. And the other?
Or 0a 4000 something g.
Okay. Tell me what that something is. Okay. let's do it this way. Let's say that this is 850. Okay? And G is 1000. So the profit of these two cases are identical, because 10 times 850 is 8050, and 1000 times 8.5 is 8050. Okay. So this is what you wanted to do, actually. Okay, you can see that you can easily do that. Now, can I show these two points on the graph? I'm not going to do that, but you can show it actually on the graph. I will only write that two solutions here. So A850 is somewhere here, and G1000 is over here. G1000 is simple to find. So we have a line. Remember, this is sort of the 1000 mark. So we have a line which is like this. Now, what can you say about all the solutions on that line? They are all going to be equal to 8500. Any doubt on this? Because everything is linear. This is the beauty of linearity. Although it is not very realistic, it has some very nice properties. So what can I say then? So this is actually one line that shows all the solutions that give me equal profit. Now, can I draw more lines of that sort? Will they be parallel to this line? Do you know what parallel is? Okay, you know what parallel is. So this is line number one. And I am going to move in this direction. I will obtain lines that all give me equal profit. Çok yaşa. Okay, but you need to stop talking. Otherwise, I'm really disturbed. Because I cannot hear the effect of what I'm talking, and this is disturbing. I don't want to hear the effect, actually. Okay. Okay, let me repeat again. So we draw the first line. Then I will be moving using parallel lines. I will be moving in this direction. So I am going now in this direction with all parallel lines. Do you think that the profit is increasing or decreasing? Who says increasing? Who says decreasing? Okay. It is increasing. So this means that I found this line and I am drawing parallel lines to that line. It is something like this. So I am moving, but at some point in time, I will be away of the feasible region. But there is a single point at which I will have a little touch with the feasible region. Okay? Now, the line is something like this. So you move, and at this point, you see that the only point that is in touch with your parallel lines, one of the parallel lines, is this point, which is the intersection of two lines. Remember, one line, the other line, and then this is moving in this direction. That is the solution that yields you the maximum profit. Okay. Now, of course, this is a little bit hand-waving, because this is only two-dimensional. How are we going to do that in three-dimension? Well, we need to have a more systematic structure to do that. But what I explained is correct in the sense that the solution in linear programming, the optimal solution, actually follows this property that we have here. This is called, in your notes, as the corner property, corner principle. I'm going to call it extreme point in order to use better jargon, because you're going to learn the meaning of extreme point later on in another course. One optimal solution of an LP linear program always occurs at a corner point, extreme point of the feasible region. What is the meaning of feasible region? What is the meaning of extreme point of a feasible region? It is naturally çok yaşa. Okay. He wanted it. I mean, I can't prevent it. Okay. Let's go back. We have very limited time. So this property is extremely important because it simply says that the optimal solution to this problem will be in one of the extreme points. Now, how many extreme points do we have in this example? Okay, this is one extreme point. This is another extreme point. The intersection of these two lines is a third extreme point. And this is another extreme point. So we have only four extreme points in this problem. So the property says that the optimal solution is in one of them. But one of the optimal solutions, so it means that you can always have alternative optimal solutions. What happens if the line that I draw that shows the profit function is parallel to this? So I will be basically moving parallel to this, and all the solutions here will be optimal using the same logic. Okay, so the property which says is extreme point, one optimal solution of an LP always occurs at a corner point. And using this property, one can generate very efficient methods to solve a very general linear programming problem. In real life, the size of the linear programming problems that one can solve may have up to 3-4 million decision variables. Okay? So you can understand how efficient we are in solving these type of problems. This only had 2 decision variables compared to 3-4 million decision variables. Okay? So this property is used in that. So intuitively, what we are going to do is, what we did is we observed the specific objective function. We placed it over the feasible region and moved the function so to increase the profit in the northeast direction. Okay? Eventually, we will be out of the feasible region, but just stop in the last possible point, and that's the same point that you obtain. Or, in your text, actually, once given this property, you can check the profit value of each extreme point solution and select the one that gives you the best. Okay? But of course, in a problem with 3 million decision variables, with 2,000 or maybe 200,000 constraints, how many extreme points are you going to have? We don't know, but it's going to be very large. So enumerating all of them is not going to be feasible. Okay, any questions on this? Okay. Now, our quiz number 6 is going to, we're going to have it tomorrow or on Friday. If I knew, I don't want them to televise it. If I knew that this would be your reaction, I would tell it in the beginning and then ask you to fill the evaluation forms. I thought just the reverse. Okay, now, this is the question that I'm going to ask you. This is not in your notes. Of course, it is not going to be in your notes. Okay. I am going to describe a situation. Okay, this is very poetic, like the sitcoms in the TV. Describe a situation. Okay. And ask you to write the objective function. Ask you to write a constraint. Ask you the meaning of a constraint. This is going to be the question that I'm going to ask you tomorrow and on Friday. Of course, the questions are not going to be the same in different sections. Okay, any questions on the question that I'm going to ask? Okay, we're not done yet. Okay, unless you are, I have the full silence, I'm not going to quit. Full silence means full silence. Okay. Now, tomorrow, before the quiz, you can also ask questions on what I covered today. And so the quiz is not going to take the whole hour. So if you have any questions, you can ask me before the quiz. On the other hand, you will not be allowed to ask a lot of questions during the quiz, as you can expect. But if you have anything that is related to this material or the material that you are going to read tonight, I will be able to answer them before the quiz. I'll see you tomorrow or on Friday.